grateful praise. Let us stand as we join together and sing our call of worship this morning. Lord, I hold your name on high. We bless your name. We lift your name on high through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Opening hymns on page 127. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah.
Thank you. mighty deeds,
and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom,
and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
The Lord upholds all who are fallen,
and raises up all who are bowed down.
The eyes of all look to you,
and you give them their food in due season.
You open your hand,
you satisfy the desire of every living thing.
All the Lord's ways are just.
All the Lord's doings are kind.
The Lord is near to all who call.
To all who call upon the Lord in truth.
The Lord fulfills the desire of all the faithful,
and hears their cries and saves them.
All who love the Lord preserves.
All the wicked, the Lord destroys.
My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord.
Let all flesh bless God's holy name forever and ever.
Thank you. thanks for. And I'm not just talking about how Mississippi State's kicker actually showed up for the game yesterday, three times in a row. But we have a lot of good things going on. Phil Armantrout did have his heart procedure and is at home recovering. He seems to have more energy and is doing better. And so we continue to pray for Phil and Ann. And we celebrate that Ann's going to be getting the acolyte training back. And so for all of our young ones, we haven't had acolyte training, I don't think, in 3 years. So we're going to get that back going on. And nothing like giving the little ones a stick with fire on them. That would be fun. We have some good news to celebrate in our community. Our own Adrian Rayner has been voted, nominated, appointed, something dubbed Parent of the Year by the Florence Academy. Feels weird when everybody's clapping for you. We do celebrate you and appreciate you. We have some kind of good news, bad news. The bad news side is we just lost our district superintendent. The good news is we lost her because she was elected bishop to North Carolina. And so we celebrate the Reverend Dr. Connie Shelton will be leaving the Mississippi Annual Conference to go to North Carolina sometime after Christmas, but she'll still be around. So keep her and Joey in your thoughts and prayers. They've also announced that our new bishop starting January the 1st will be Tamara Lewis. I don't know if it's Dr. Lewis or not. Somebody can probably help you with that. But she has been serving as a bishop of the Richmond, Virginia area conference. And so she'll be coming to Mississippi starting in January the 1st. And so we pray for all the change in leadership and God's will be done and soothe all the hearts. We all look forward to working together in mission and ministry. Concerns, and I know we got some struggles, but anybody else got anything they need to lift up?
I want to thank the Holy God for you have surgery Wednesday.
Okay.
It was all turned out good.
All right. Continue to pray for Jeff. Anybody else?
Maybe the Devon Loggins turned in his resignation at the children's office. We're going to go to work with the state and CPS.
Okay.
There will be a new CEO at the Children's Office in December. So we pray for that transition.
David is saying that the CEO of the Methodist Children's Home that we support in so many ways is moving on to another job and hopefully a better one for him. But that leaves an opening for the children that need special love and care. So let's pray for that and pray for God's guidance there.
We need to continue praying for Grace Ann Maine, Jeff and Terry's daughter-in-law. She's awaiting surgery.
Can you pray for Grace Ann? Yes, ma'am.
Jim was at home today dealing with kidney stones. He went to the emergency room Thursday, and they did find out about the stones, and he's on meds, you know, past the stone, and also for pain. And I have a second request. I don't know how many of you remember Angela Harrell and B.J. Harrell that lived in Florence for a long time. And I called Angela. I had heard this on the news, but I didn't know that it was Angela's daughter that died in a car accident where the three junior college students were driving, and she was a passenger, and her friend was driving, and then they had a roll in the backseat. And the driver of the other car, none of them were hurt at all. But they're having that funeral today, and just prayers for them. And the girl that died is Lindsay Peavy, and her father is my son-in-law's cousin, and he is a pallbearer at the funeral today. So just prayers for that family, the Harrells and Peavys.
Prayers for the Harrell and Peavy family. I know that there's a lot of us, a lot of folks among us that are taking care of somebody. Anybody out there? All right. Anybody just got somebody that they keep in their hearts that they want to lift up and not name out loud? God knows our prayers long before we pray. So, as we unite our hearts and as we claim God's presence, the Lord be with you. Precious God, what a privilege it is to gather in your name. And Lord, on this special week where we have so much to celebrate, it seems that we have announced that there's a lot of transition. There's a lot of change. There's a lot of uncertainty. And Lord, even as our country goes to the polls, our hearts are filled with a lot of tension. Lord, I pray that we find a foundation of faith in you, to know that you are still the same God, yesterday, today, and forever. Know that our outreach, our love, our consistency in your kingdom has not changed. And most importantly of all, your love for us has not changed. Help us to live and to be an example in our community, in our country, and in your kingdom, so that when people look to us, they see you, and that they find the assurances that we need to live day by day. For those that struggle, we lift up. For those that need healing, Lord, your holy touch. For all of us, we need encouragement of spirit, that we may know your peace. Pray all of this in Christ's holy name.
Thank you.
passage, except to say that's a familiar passage of Moses coming to meet God at the burning bush, the bush that was on fire but yet wasn't consumed. Just keep that as an image because Jesus makes reference to it in Luke chapter 20. And in Luke chapter 20, I'll begin reading in 27. But before I do that, I always like to set the scene, you know, a little bit of history, because while Rome was in control, and Rome had very strict authority over everybody in the first century, Rome allowed the Jewish people to govern themselves, at least religiously, up to a point, as long as it didn't get out of hand. But ever since all the Greek and Roman influence came into the area, there were some conservative Jewish groups that broke apart. They called them sects. S-E-C-T-S. Sects. If I can say that right. And four main ones kind of come, rise up out of history. The scribes and the Essenes may not be ones you're very familiar with, but they're the ones that left us with the Dead Sea Scrolls, and so they're very important, even though they're not really talked about a whole lot in our scriptures. But the two big groups that are talked about, of course, are the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And the Sadducees remained in control of the Great Council of Sanhedrin, and they like to think that they're in charge. Now, anytime one of these groups comes up and they start referring to Jesus and they say, "Teacher, tell us about something, or we've got a question for you," just let a little red light go off in the back of your head, because they're usually trying to trip him up. Usually trying to make him make a mistake. Usually trying to get him to step out of line so they can find an angle to get him. Because as long as there were these different sects, they were fighting, they were fussing. They were always arguing over some little issue. One of the big issues for the Sadducees was an issue of resurrection. And so the Sadducees bring up to Jesus a hypothetical situation, a crazy situation, to see how Jesus responds. So we'll pick up in Luke 20, starting in verse 27. "Some of the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, they came to Jesus with a question. 'Teacher,' they said, 'Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife, but no children, that man must marry the widow and have children for the brother. And now there were seven brothers. The first one married the woman and died childless. The second, and then the third married her. And in the same way, the seven died, leaving no children. And finally, the woman died too. Now then, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be? And since the seven were married to her?' And Jesus replied, 'The people of this age marry and are given in marriage. But those who are considered worthy of taking part in that age and in the resurrection from the dead will neither marry nor be given in marriage. And if they can no longer die, they are like the angels. They are God's children. And since they are children of the resurrection, but the account of the bush, even Moses, showed that the dead rise, and he called for the Lord, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and he is not the God of the dead, but of the living. For to him, all are alive.' And some of the teachers of the law responded, 'Well said, teacher,' and no one dared to ask him any more questions." Beloved, it's the word of God for the people of God. Let the people say,
"Thanks be to God."
Lord, like the Pharisees and Sadducees before us, we have lots of questions. We have lots of concerns. Speak to us in our heart of hearts that even though we may not get the answers that we want, Lord, we get the affirmation that you've got it and you're in control, that we may find peace, and that we may know that you are your children. In Christ's holy name, amen. We all ready to vote Tuesday?
Yep.
Oh, I just stepped in it, didn't I? Go right for the jugular. No, you know, I've got a sister in Florida, and I've got a sister in Pennsylvania, and right now they just turned the TV off. There's nothing that they can watch. It's not some kind of political announcement or something, and each one telling things about the others, and they just can't stomach it. So they turn it off, and they pray. They pray, "Lord, give us strength." Because in the midst of all of this kind of So we're getting more and more divided. We're getting more and more torn apart. And our country seems to be more and more at risk. And we need something. We need something that is spiritual. We need something that no one can ever take away from us. We need something that holds us together as the people of God. And what I want you to hear today is that Jesus gave us that something. What I want you to know is that this is nothing new. This has been going on perhaps throughout all time. And even as we read in the first century, Jesus had to deal with the separations, the fussing, even of the sects that wanted to keep Judaism in a conservative way and wanted to keep the faith, they found that they were fighting it amongst themselves. And one of the big issues was about resurrection. So they come to Jesus, and the Sadducees kind of come up with this hypothetical situation, because according to Mosaic law, if a man marries and he dies, but they have no children, the brother is supposed to marry and have children for a lineage for that deceased brother. That's according to Mosaic law. Well, what if there are seven brothers, and they each try and take their duty in Mosaic tradition, and there are no children? Well, in the resurrection, whose wife will she be? Yee, that's a head scratcher. Remember, these aren't Mormons. These are, okay. Maybe I just stepped in there. Jesus tries to respond in talking about an area of faith, an area of living, a way of being that really has nothing to do with resurrection, and it really has nothing to do with death, but it has everything to do with life and life eternal. Because Jesus is trying to point out, and it's not obvious here, but this is my interpretation. He's trying to lift out the spiritual side of things and suppress the physical side of things. He's trying to remind us of what is holy, what is godlike, what is created of God. Because what I want each and every person here to hear is that you are spiritual beings created in the image of God. Y'all know that. You are a spiritual being created in the image of God. From the time of eternity, God gave you life, and that was a spiritual life. The downside is, it's in this physical body. And this physical body, like all physical things, falls apart. Is there an amen?
Amen.
Okay, just want to know. So I'm not the only one. It gets fat. It gets a little ugly. It gets a broken arm. It gets a cold. It gets diabetes. It gets cancer. And one day, it just goes away. But the affirmation that we need to hear as we are spiritual children is that the spiritual side of us continues and it does not change. And it was and it is and it will always be. So when we start to have this argument about resurrection and who marries who, that's beside the point. That's missing the issue. That's forgetting who we are and what we are in the image of God. I'll make another point. So I have this book here in front of me. I read from it. This book is made of paper. It's got some ink. It's got some leather, a little bit of cloth. It's got some shiny little gold edges. And I can take this physical book and I can tear it up. I can burn it. I can grind it to dust. And I can get rid of this book. But as long as the Word of God resides in our hearts, nobody can ever take that away from us. You understand? The Spirit can never be taken away. The physical, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. But God's Spirit resides in us forever. And the affirmation that we need to cling to is to focus on that which brings us together in God, that which unites us. The physical things divide us. As much as we may fight over all the little details of politics and boundaries and such as that, they divide us. But when Jesus got together with his best friends in that upper room, he was not trying to divide the world. He was trying to bring it together in a great and selfless act. He took the physical elements and he blessed them. And he said, these are spiritual elements, this bread and this wine. It becomes my body and my blood. In a spiritual sense, it blesses the world. It will never go away. As long as people gather at the table, it will never, ever go away. And that is what, as Christians, we come together. We live in a country, the United States of America. And inside that, we live in Mississippi, and we live in Rankin County or Simpson County or somewhere close by. And we live in Florence or Pearl or all these little areas, and we like to claim our citizenships. But even in that much, those citizenships might divide us. We might fight over boundaries. We may fight over resources. But this is not what God calls us to do and be. I love the psalmist here who says, "Thou shalt speak of the glory of what? Your kingdom. And tell of your power. To make known to all the people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom." Your kingdom is what, a physical kingdom with boundaries? No. It's an everlasting kingdom. And your dominion endures throughout all generations. No one can ever destroy that. No one can ever destroy what God has created. No one can ever destroy the spiritual side of who you are. And no one can ever destroy God's kingdom, even next to you. I encourage us to remember how Christ brought us together as we come once again to the table, to remember just how God has called us to be a part of his kingdom. I invite Reverend Roger Flowers and Keith Walmers, and he covered up and leads us in the liturgy starting on page 13. I invite you to join us.
The body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, with confidence of the children of God, let us pray that prayer that our Lord taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Servants, if you would come up first. God, just as you were the suffering servant, we give you thanks for those that dedicate their lives in service to you. In Christ's holy name. Amen. Can invite our choir, please come down first. Table is an open table. It's a table for the faith of all Christians and Christians of all faiths. card for our Thanksgiving bags. We invite you to come under the direction of the ushers.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you from now on and forevermore. Amen. As these go, let others come. Feeble minds, we make mistakes. And it's good that Christ died even for our mistakes. So we ask for forgiveness, but we strive for perfection in Christ who died for us. Because God has not made mistakes. I invite you to stand and join me as we close on page 395. Take time to be holy. 395. peace unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And all God's children say,
Amen.